core problem is our ability to create information has far exceeded our ability to manage it.
We're kind of like we're drowning in our richness. That's kind of what's happening. Because you have all this data, all these access points, and there's really no way to help you really deal with it, except for stuff you can pull into your human brain. And you can only pull in so much.
So you've got this massive amount of potential, but there's not any real tools to harness it.
We have so much stuff that we have to deal with, individually, as a culture. So much, it just bursts the bounds of any physical library. You know, if we had a Dewey Decimal System for everything on the web, the trillion pages and all of the subpages on it, we wouldn't find a thing. That system simply can't work.
The amount of media that's available to the average user is a vastly much larger superset than anything that's ever existed in human history. If I was going to start a news business tomorrow, I would start a news business designed to produce not one new bit of news, but instead to aggregate news for individuals in ways that matter to them.
Google really was more important as the web was in millions of pages. Now we're entering a web that's going to be billions, well, it already is, but it's going to be billions and billions of pages and soon trillions of pages, because a tweet is actually, every individual item is a page. Every product in the world, the whole world, everything you can name or address is going to have a page. And so that's trillions of things. And Google doesn't scale to that.
There should be enough information out there that you should be able to ask for something extraordinarily specific, but you can't. You pretty much have to do all the integration in your own head. You've got to come back and see all the stuff that comes back from Google. Say, oh, I wonder how I could ask that, because this was kind of right, but this was wrong. And, oh, I see why it came back, came this out. That isn't what I want, though.
So that's not really a search. I think people use the word search to mean a sort of parachuting in, crossing your fingers, and hoping to land somewhere really good.
You know, when you're looking for a camera and you go to some place, there's like 10,000 cameras, and you're overwhelmed. And sort of studies show that people actually are less likely to buy something when they're overwhelmed by these things and less likely to actually be happy with what they buy afterwards.
We have too many emails, so we start to tag them or label them. Gmail calls them labels. And we start to apply labels. And then we get, maybe we start to get hundreds of labels and we think, oh, geez, now I got to label my labels.
All the tweets and all of the MySpace. And you can start to say, what if I could start to put things together and all that in that flow of information? And in order to do that, you would need some structure.
It's clear that something needs to be done with more structured data.
It's like all the information might be out there. It's just if it's indexed in a really inaccessible form, you know, a lot of times it might as well not be out there, right?
That is in many ways the problem of the edge, right? Content, as it turns out, is not king.
We are always going to be filtering the filters that filter our filters that filter our filters.
How do I find the right file? How do I know that all those files belong there?
How do you integrate data? How do I keep up with all of these new sources of information?
How do you filter things to create more value than you can currently get?
That is what the semantic web could eventually promise to do.
I wanted to reframe the way we use information, the way we work together. Now, 20 years on, I want to ask your help in a new reframing. I want you to put your data on the web. Okay, data is brown and boxy and boring, and that's how we think of it, isn't it, data? But in fact, data is about our lives. You log onto your social networking site, you pick your favorite one, you say, this is my friend, bing, relationship, data. You say, this photograph, oh, it's about, it depicts this person, bing, that's data. Data, data, data.
The semantic web at its lowest level is just an expression of information, that's all it is. So how the web works today, for the most part, is human to human. A human being put something in some format. The computer is all it knows about formatting information. It knows it's supposed to make this bold. It knows that it's supposed to underline this. The computer doesn't know anything more than it's just a bunch of bits. So semantics merely adds extra information to help you with the meaning of the information.
It's really just like transforming the web into something that's a little bit more like a database. trying to make it a lot easier to find stuff because we have an understanding and an index of what's out there.
So you have specific data items, whether they're books or songs or news articles or people, and linking them together. And with semantic web technologies, the links mean something.
It's all about relationships. It's about relationships of one string to another string, or one number to another number. And if I have enough of those relationships, I start to build context, and context is what it's all about. If I said any kind of word, it's the context that surrounds the word that really gave you the meaning. What your brain has really done is connected that one word with all kinds of relationships. In a technical sense, is all the semantic web does is start to give all these relationships.
If you look at the original proposal for the web, there are different shapes for different things like people and documents, and there are arrows going between them, and the arrows are labeled. So this includes this, this describes this. So I think the idea of wanting to capture the meaning of the relationships, capture the actual data, has been there for ages,
We know that there's a structure to this. There's a structure to all the information on the internet.
The reason there aren't too many criticisms of the semantic web yet is that it operates in its own bubble. I think I'm unusual in having 6 or 8 years ago gone out with a set of opinions that said this isn't working because it's not a good idea and it's never going to work.
Semantic web is a word that began with a technical meaning. Now it's that word has morphed into a marketing term that's sort of abused and thrown around, and so I would almost argue to the extent that it's maybe not a useful word anymore.
In terms of the semantic web, the idea is that everything is linked. I still like that idea. I think potentially that's a utopian idea to strive for.
In an ideal world, if everybody was trained in database and knowledge representation technology, that's how we would do it.
I've often joked that the semantic web is a witness protection program for AI researchers, right? That what the semantic web held out was the possibility that instead of making machines think like people, we could describe the world in terms that machines were good at thinking about. So we would switch from trying to build up brains in silicon and instead re-render the actual world as information. And that gets very quickly to one of the deepest, questions in all of Western philosophy, which is, does the world make sense, or do we make sense of the world? I don't think you can unambiguously describe the world. I don't think you can describe the world, or even large subdomains of the world, in a way that all observers, or even most observers, will agree with.
Unlike in the old days, where we had a card catalog, and if you had a million ways of sorting through the card catalog, you just had a big mess. Now we have computers, and we can do a million ways or a trillion ways of sorting through on demand. The notion that there is a single right way of categorizing that doesn't even occur to people, nor should it.